I wrote an article as part of the Pugwash conference with which I was involved, in which I raised this catch-22 question: how can a third world country ever become a first world country in science when there's this enormous gulf, and when, you know, they may develop, but the developing country develops, of course, more rapidly, so the gulf becomes wider and wider. And furthermore, the third world countries have priorities of simply literacy and first grade and high school education, whereas here we're talking about centers of excellent research. How could you break this? And I wrote a model based on my experience in Brazil, saying one could perhaps do this by having visiting directors of research from highly developed countries who would work in the developed country. They, of course, would not be willing to abandon their labs, so they would only be on a part-time basis, but they'd have postdocs of theirs there and train local people right in situ rather than bringing them to the highly developed country and spoiling them by American or British or European standards, but rather show what can be done in a third world country. And at the same time, those visitors, part-time people, would really learn something of the problems that existed there. And do that model. And an African, a very interesting African scientist, Tom Odhiambo, a Kenyan insect physiologist, endocrinologist, read that and got in touch with me, said, how about trying it in Kenya? And I gave some models. I said, Nairobi, Caracas. I used a couple of examples, would be typical one, because they had to be places that you could get easily to. Nairobi was always on the line of all the airlines at that time. All, of course, went down to South Africa, but stopped there. And politically, Kenya at that time was perhaps the most stable country. This was still in the post-Kenyatta days, before even the all the problems arose there. And I said, why not? So we eventually came together and founded something called icipe, the International Center for Insect Physiology and Ecology in Nairobi. Why insects? Because in a separate area, which I haven't mentioned, one other involvement of mine has been insect physiology and ecology. And I founded a company called Zoicon in 1968, the year when DDT was banned, about developing new approaches for insect control, which do not involve pesticides, but hormones, similar to the birth control pill, on the Stanford Industrial Park. So I knew something about that particular field. And we said, here's a good example. I mean, we would establish a center of excellence in Kenya in a really very interesting new area, endocrinology of insects, which was a new scientific area. But where the endpoint was a very serious one, namely study the insect physiology of mosquitoes, of the main diseases. In other words, sleeping sickness, malaria, and some other tropical diseases which are spread, vectors that are spread by particular insects. And yet you could do really fancy research that would be recognized everywhere and yet would have immediate application to that particular country. Furthermore, let's take a tsetse fly. You are not even permitted to do research on the tsetse fly in places like the United States because, of course, they don't want to introduce the tsetse fly there, so you'd want to do it in situ anyway. And so we founded icipe, which has become one of the major African research institutes, eventually was taken over by the World Bank and so on, and funded, and still is in existence. And eventually trained quite a lot of African scientists and became a really African institution.